Chemists live in a fantasy world. Okay, maybe that's not fair, but I can't help but point out that this gas law is called the ideal gas law, not the real gas law. The ideal gas law is for an idealized, theoretical conception of gases that doesn't match reality, except under certain conditions. It's a model of gas behavior that helps make the math simpler. Real quick here, let me tell you the differences between ideal gases and real gases. An ideal gas is composed of particles that are like the tiniest perfect spheres, vanishingly small, like when you talk about points in math. So the individual particles aren't taking up any space. That's weird and not based in reality, but again, it makes the math much simpler. And most of the time, it's basically true. The particles of gas take up a negligible amount of space compared to the entire volume a gas is occupying. Picture a helium balloon. It's mostly empty space, not solid helium. So we can get away with this assumption, except at very high pressure when you squeeze particles of gas close to each other, and all of a sudden, oops, the volume of gas particles matters very much, thank you. Excuse me, stop pushing me! When ideal gas particles run into each other, they bounce off each other without losing any energy. Must be nice, never needing any energy, just bouncing around forever. Again, that's not reality, but we can get away with this assumption much of the time because the amount of energy lost when real gas particles collide is so small it's a rounding error. We also say that ideal gases aren't attracted to each other. This is another unreal assumption. Remember, intermolecular forces are a thing. There are gases that are attracted to each other. This is especially significant at low temperatures, when gas particles slow down. Now, the intermolecular forces become more comparable to the kinetic energy of the particles. What's more, if you cool a real gas down far enough, eventually there will be a phase change into liquid, and that's definitely no longer an ideal gas. We never consider phase changes when we talk about ideal gases. So by now, you should have the idea that the ideal gas model breaks down when you look at very low temperatures and very high pressure. But lucky for us, most of the time, those aren't the conditions we live in. Most of the time in the real world, or in the lab, when we're studying gases, these conditions work just fine for the mathematical predictions of the ideal gas law to come out right. Now let's talk about this ideal gas law, just keeping this idea in the back of our mind that it especially works well at higher temperature and lower pressure. The ideal gas law equation is PV equals nRT. P stands for pressure. V stands for volume. N is the number of moles of the gas. T is the temperature. And R is the ideal gas constant, which makes the math work. Pressure is directly proportional to the number of molecules and temperature. In other words, if you add more molecules of a gas, they will bang around more on the container and exert more pressure. Similarly, if you increase the temperature of a gas, that increases its kinetic energy. It'll have more collisions per second against the container, which means the gas is exerting more pressure. So, pressure and temperature are also directly proportional to each other. Pressure is inversely proportional to volume. If you increase the size of the container, now there will be fewer collisions per second. But if you compress the container and make the volume smaller, now the particles will hit the sides more often per second. Lower volume, higher pressure. Higher volume, lower pressure. If you find the directly proportional or inversely proportional concepts confusing, I recommend you spend some time thinking about the graphs of these variables, graphing just two variables at a time. The relationship between pressure and volume is Boyle's law. PV equals a constant. So, as pressure goes up, volume goes down. As volume goes up, pressure goes down. That's an inverse relationship. Now, keep in mind, this only holds if temperature and the number of particles of gas stays constant. Here's Charles's law, which is the relationship between volume and temperature. V over T is a constant. These two variables are directly proportional. The volume of a gas decreases when the temperature falls. If you raise the temperature, the gas expands. The volume increases. These two variables move in the same direction, so it's a direct relationship. Notice that pressure and the number of gas particles aren't part of this equation. You can also say that pressure and number of gas particles are constant. Avogadro's law relates the volume with the quantity of gas. V over N is a constant. These are also directly related. The more gas particles you have, the more room they will take up. Again, notice that pressure and temperature are not part of Avogadro's law. Avogadro's law works if pressure and temperature are held constant. If you put Boyle's law, Charles's law, and Avogadro's law together, you get the ideal gas law equation, PV equals NRT. Here we have one constant, R, the ideal gas constant, which is a combination of the constants from the other gas laws. Keep in mind the same relationships exist between the variables as in the simpler laws. Pressure and volume are still inversely related. Volume and temperature are still directly related. In the meantime, until it clicks, remember that values on the same side of the ideal gas law equation are inversely proportional to each other when you hold all the other variables constant. By the same token, values on opposite sides of the equation are directly proportional to each other when the other variables are held constant. Now let's work on some example problems to see the ideal gas law in action. We're going to do 5 complete example problems. If you need more help, especially if you're studying for a test, we have a gas laws practice test with a complete answer key. This is available for purchase on our website, socratica.com. We'll add a link in the description. Before we get started, I want to remind you to keep your eye on units. Pay close attention to the units of things like pressure and temperature, and make sure they match the units you use for R, the ideal gas constant. You might have to stop and do a conversion before you plug things in. Here's what we're using for R. And so in our practice problems, we'll convert units as needed so everything matches. My other piece of advice is to always work the problem as far as you can using the general equation with variables before you plug in values for P, V, N, and T. This lets your instructor know that you know which is the right equation to use and how it works. Don't just write down numbers from the problem, because if you're wrong, you won't get any partial credit. Example 1. You feed your dog a new kind of kibble that doesn't agree with him. You think fast, and you save your family, by capturing the 10 moles of smelly gas he produces in a tank. The tank is 3 meters by 3 meters by 4.5 meters. What is the pressure produced by the gas if you keep the temperature at 15 degrees Celsius? The ideal gas law is PV equals NRT. Write that down first and solve for the variable you need. So we solve for P, pressure, by dividing both sides by V, volume. P equals NRT over V. R equals 8.31 liters times kilopascals over degrees Kelvin times moles. Now, substitute in the values from the problem. We'll have to do a little converting to make sure the units match the units we have in the gas constant. We need the volume to be in liters, and we need the temperature to be in Kelvin. Volume of the tank is 3 meters times 3 meters times 4.5 meters, which is 40.5 cubic meters. 1 liter equals 0.001 cubic meters. So volume equals 40.5 meters cubed times 1 liter over 0.001 meters cubed equals 40,500 liters. That's a lot of gas. The other conversion we need to do is the temperature. It's in Celsius and we need it in Kelvin. Temperature in Kelvin equals temperature in Celsius plus 273.15. This equals 15 plus 273.15, which equals 288.15 Kelvin. Now let's substitute everything in. P equals nRT over V. That equals 10 times 8.31 liters times kilopascals over Kelvin times mole times 288.15 Kelvin divided by 40,500 liters. That equals 0.59 kilopascals. So you just need to make sure your tank can withstand 0.59 kilopascals of pressure so the gas doesn't escape and poison your family. Speaking of poisoning your family, let's see example two. Your grandmother insists on using an antique coal stove. It produces toxic carbon monoxide at a rate of 5 moles per hour. How long will it take to generate 10 liters of gas if the temperature is 20 degrees Celsius and the pressure is 0.8 atmospheres? PV equals nRT. R equals 8.31 liters kilopascals over Kelvin mole, so we'll have to convert atmospheres to kilopascals and temperature from Celsius to Kelvin. One atmosphere equals 101.3 kilopascals. 0.8 atmospheres times 101.3 kilopascals over one atmosphere equals 81.04 kilopascals. 20 degrees Celsius plus 273.15 equals 293.15 Kelvin. The problem asks, how long will it take? We have a conversion factor here. 5 moles are produced per hour. So we'll use the ideal gas law and solve for n, number of moles, and then use that conversion factor to get the number of hours. N equals PV over RT, which equals 81.04 kilopascals times 10 liters divided by 8.31 liters kilopascals over Kelvin mole times 293.15. This equals 810.4 divided by 2,436.08, which equals 0.33 moles. We're not finished, hang on. That's the number of moles, and the question, remember, is how long does it take to generate that much gas? Let's use the conversion factor from the problem, 5 moles per hour. 0.33 moles times 1 hour over 5 moles equals 0.07 hours, or a little less than 5 minutes. Let's look at a happier example. It's your birthday. Your family takes you to the beach, and you get a new bicycle. It's perfect, except it has 2 flat tires. If the volume of each tire needs to be 0.45 liters, how many moles of gas will you need to pump on a hot 28 degrees Celsius day? Here's a little trick. The pressure at sea level is 1 atmosphere. I doubt your instructor would make you know that by heart, but it doesn't hurt. We'll use the ideal gas law, PV equals nRT, and solve for n, number of moles. N equals PV over RT. R equals 8.31 liters kilopascals over Kelvin mole, so we'll have to convert atmospheres to kilopascals and temperature from Celsius to Kelvin. 1 atmosphere equals 101.3 kilopascals. 28 degrees Celsius plus 273.15 equals 301.15 Kelvin. N equals 101.3 kilopascals times 2 times 0.45 liters, remember there are 2 tires, divided by 8.31 liters kilopascals over Kelvin mole, times 301.15 Kelvin. This equals 0.04 moles of gas. You really want to take a hot air balloon ride, but you can't afford a ticket. Instead, you tie 100 big helium balloons to your lawn chair and hope for the best. Each balloon has 40 moles of helium. You take off from a hill next to your house where the air pressure is 50 kilopascals. Your departure time is 6 a.m. when the temperature is 12 degrees Celsius. At noon, the temperature has risen to 18 degrees Celsius. You look up and you see the balloons have gotten much bigger. What is the difference in volume per balloon? First, what is the volume at 6 a.m.? PV equals nRT, and solve for V. So volume 1, V1, equals nRT1 over P. This equals 40 times 8.31 times 285.15 over 50 kilopascals, which equals 1895.68 liters. What's the new volume at noon? So now we're looking for V2. V2 equals nRT2 over P, which equals 40 times 8.31 times 291.15 divided by 50, which equals 1935.57 liters. The difference, V2 minus V1, equals 1935.57 minus 1895.68, which equals 39.89 liters per balloon. Here's a challenge for you. Think about if you had to use the ideal gas law here, like we just did. Could this problem have been simplified given that the number of moles and pressure were unchanged? Elon Musk heard about your sad balloon trip, and he felt sorry for you, so he offers to send you to space for a week. The catch is, you're going to be all on your own in the little capsule. A solo astronaut produces about 1 kilogram of CO2 every day. What volume of CO2 will you produce during your 7-day trip? You'll be at 2.7 Kelvin and 101.3 kilopascals. Now in this problem, we have a mass of CO2, not the number of moles. To use the ideal gas law, PV equals nRT, we're going to have to convert from mass to number of moles. We can do that using the molar mass of CO2, that is, the mass of 1 mole of that compound. This is also sometimes called the gram molecular mass. If you need some review on that, we have a video on how to do this. We'll share a link to that video. Find the molar masses for each element from the periodic table. The mass of 1 mole of carbon atoms is 12.01 grams. The mass of 1 mole of oxygen atoms is 16.00 grams. 1 mole of CO2 equals 12.01 plus 2 times 16.00 equals 44.01 grams per mole. N equals 1,000 grams of CO2 times 1 mole per 44.01 grams equals 22.72 moles. PV equals nRT, solve for V. V equals nRT over P. This equals 22.72 times 8.31 times 2.7 divided by 101.3, which equals 5.03 liters of CO2 gas per day times 7 days, which equals 35.2 liters. Socratica friends, one of my big secrets for successful studying is to only study what you don't know. This only works if you have a good practice test. Your instructor may have a practice test for you, or there might be one at the end of the chapter of your textbook. If you want to get your hands on a good quality practice test with the answers worked out in full, we have one for sale on our website, socratica.com. Your purchase means we'll be able to make more videos like this one, completely free for you. Thanks for watching.